Last year there was no fatalities, and I'd like to see if we can keep it again that way again this season as well.
No over-the-counter service at many Commonwealth banks today on the eve of the long weekend. 70% of Hunter branches were closed in protest. Staff shortages have led to longer customer queues and employees are demanding more staff. They're also seeking a 6.5% wage increase over the next 2 years, so far to no avail.
No, unfortunately negotiations have broken down and that has led to the industrial action that's being taken today. The staff just can't take it anymore at the present time.
No further industrial action is planned at this stage. Meanwhile, staff at the Hunter Institute of TAFE have rallied against state budget cuts, with a $7.1 million reduction forcing 94 employees out of a job.
For a Premier that came into his time as the leader of the Labor Party in New South Wales and stating that he was the Education Premier, I don't think he's doing a very good job.
Staff voted unanimously to lobby state and federal politicians and take industrial action if necessary. The gateway to the Barrington Tops will be relying on the sun more than ever to draw tourists. It's now home to Australia's first solar-powered visitor centre.
People can actually walk inside the facility and read a meter to see the energy being produced at any time of the day. That's quite a first.
The 10-panel system converts sunlight into 1.1 kilowatts of electricity, 25% of the power consumed at the centre, while reducing greenhouse gas emissions.
It will save 40 tonnes of energy in carbon dioxide equivalent being put up into the atmosphere over the life of the system.
The Minister assisting the Premier on Hunter development, Richard Face, applauded the innovative centre, initiated by local council and government agencies.
We're the envy throughout Australia that we can get collectively together, that's to say industry, commerce, the unions, the communities most importantly, can work collectively together to get a good end result.
On crutches and out of football for at least 4 weeks. It's a far cry from State of Origin glory, but for Ben Kennedy it's reality after tearing ankle ligaments on Wednesday night.
If it tears, it can mean my season and maybe a lot longer, you know, and it'll mean if it tore, it probably screws through my ankles and things like that, so I don't want to go through that.
On top of that, the one-time Raider misses the chance to return to Canberra in Newcastle colours. While not running at tonight's training, centre Matt Gidley will play despite his calf muscle injury.
It's improved already, you know, a fair bit from yesterday, so, you know, I'll be spoiled for Sunday.
Gidley hopes to have a run tomorrow in Canberra as all players get used to Sean Rudder at 5'8".
Yeah, he was a half for all his junior footy, so I think he'll be right. I mean, he's got one of the best there to help him out, Joey, playing halfback this week, so, you know, Joey will help him out.
Prop Paul Rahihi comes back into the side as well for Matt Parsons, who's still troubled by a knee injury, while lock Bill Peden and Tamana Tahu sat out training today with a dose of the flu, but both are expected to play. Either way, it'll be cold reception at Bruce Stadium on Sunday night, a place Newcastle has never won at, but that means little to Canberra.
No, it doesn't. We know that they're a very good side. We know that they're going to play out the AMNs and test us.
Meanwhile, it's expected Matthew Johns' playing future will be revealed next week. Jim Callinan, NBN News.
For 10 years now, they've been herding sheep down Merriwar's main street in the Festival of the Fleeces. And rightly so, the town was built and still relies heavily on the wool clip. It's not quite Spain's running of the bulls, but thousands still flock to the running of the sheep, some even rugging up in the festival's namesake. At first, there was confusion just which way to go, but with a little prompting from a faithful working dog, the sheep made their way down the main street. As if that's not strange enough for city folk, several donned their best red socks for the big day. The sheep were then followed by a grand street parade. Festivities will continue across the weekend, including dog trials and a shearing contest. Blake Doyle, NBN News.
Nesca Parade in Cooks Hill was the focal point for Newcastle Police last night when they arrested David Richard Wilcox around 6 p.m. His brother Brian was still holed up in Unit 7 of this building. Negotiators were called in, but the arrest was only made after police with a search warrant broke down the door just before midnight. In court this morning, the brutal details of police allegations of attempted murder were read out. A witness has told them he drove past two men on a track at Belmont South and saw them handling a body wrapped in a blood-covered shower curtain. He then followed two men in a car, which was later identified as the victim's. He had been savagely attacked with an axe. His skull was fractured to the extent that his brain was exposed. His left little toe was almost severed. Police couldn't speak to him for almost a week as he was in a critical condition in John Hunter Hospital. Charged with wounding with intent to murder, the Wilcox brothers were both refused bail. David, the younger of the two, was also charged with three drug matters and the possession of $2,600. They will next appear in front of Newcastle local court on Tuesday. David McElwain, NBN News. Residents of Saltash have long been protesting the presence of the bombing range near their homes, but they deny attacking FA-18s with helium balloons and detonators.
It seems to me like it's more like a plant than something that's actually happening. I don't think none of the people I know who might be involved would ever put detonators on a balloon. They're not those sort of people.
Craig Leggett says action has been taken to get the Minister for Defence to move the bombing range from Saltash.
Because they're not getting any satisfactory answers from the Minister, have taken things in their own hands, and they've started releasing helium balloons with foil attached. It's not dangerous to the aircraft, but it'll keep them away from the homes. That's the theory behind them.
The Federal Police say as many as 9 or 10 balloons have been released into the atmosphere, and they are now investigating a serious offence under the Aviation Act. It carries a penalty of 14 years in prison. But Mr. Leggett says it's dangerous to have low-level jets flying around with live ammunition when even a bird could bring one down.
If you don't give people hope, people become desperate. Desperate people do desperate things.
Meanwhile, passengers at Newcastle Airport were delayed for more than 2 hours last night when taxiing lights were cut off. Airport management says the RAAF is in charge of the lights and repaired the situation.
In many ways, retailer Harvey Norman is a pioneer, venturing online to offer its customers another avenue for buying or viewing its products. While the bulk of products is still sold from its stores, orders are coming in from customers where the company doesn't have a store. Harvey Norman uses its stores as pseudo-warehouses, a combination known in the industry as clicks and mortar. It cuts delivery times and offers backup in case of problems. But many e-tailers are starting from scratch.
We're not just building a website, you know, we're building a new business system. We're building a whole new channel to the consumer, and it takes a lot of specialised skills.
Skills to get the product out, but also to turn the process of clicking a mouse into something more.
We're trying to convince consumers to try and do things in a different way. And if we're not coming up with a service that has better, you know, quality than what they're used to, then why would they switch over?
The canny companies know they have to go the extra mile, the all-important last one home. Gift site Wishlist has started doing its own deliveries to ensure things like presents don't turn up late. It may seem pretty impersonal, but the bottom line is the outcome at the end of it all, what's known in the jargon of the trade as customer fulfilment.
The whole experience is actually receiving something that looks like it's walked out of a David Jones and not something that's gone 10 rounds with Mike Tyson.
Even a trip to the supermarket is now just a mouse click away. Greengrocer.com is one company cashing in, the business expanding fivefold last year. But that's not something that can be taken for granted.
You can't force them to buy from you. You have to do everything 100% right every time to keep them happy.
In the US, the race is on to come up with new technology to make internet shopping even easier. A barcoding system is being tested where a handheld device scans products for easy ordering. In tomorrow's report, just how safe is it to buy online? Buying on the internet offers a whole new shopping experience, letting you shop around the world without leaving home. This could be handy if you live in a remote area or physically can't get to the shops, or even if you just don't have the time.
They have the convenience of being able to shop 24 hours a day, depending upon their time schedules. And I think putting all those things together, it's really focusing on those parts of the community that are, let's say, time poor.
Almost 800,000 Australians have so far tried internet shopping, but is it catching on across the board? According to an Australian Bureau of Statistics report, twice as many internet shoppers live in metropolitan centres than in rural areas. Regional shoppers are also spending less. 89% spend less than $500 a year online.
We're probably still experimenting a little bit more and not spending quite as much. In fact, the amount that people have purchased in the last 12 months, it tends to be lower than what's being purchased throughout Australia.
However, the tyranny of distance can affect the cost and availability of internet connection to regional areas.
Until everybody within Australia has sort of the ability to access the internet, such as people in the Lower Hunter or Sydney has, then there will be a slower uptake in regional areas.
While significant advances have been made in the online shopping industry, shopping malls aren't about to crumble from neglect just yet. Of the 600,000 Australians who bought their Christmas gifts online last year, less than one-third of the total spending went on the net.
I doubt that obviously the internet will ever substitute for the shopping experience, which is a lot more than just purchasing items.
At the end of the day, while internet shopping is on the increase, it still has a long way to go before it can compete with stores.
It's early days, but like a lot of technology and the adoption of technology, it's got to start somewhere.
Tanya Carlisle, NBN News. The information revolution has well and truly dawned, and Australians are embracing it. A quarter of all households, or 1.7 million people, are now able to access the internet. That's up by more than a third in just 12 months. But what's also on the increase is the number of people starting to shop over the net. Once solely the domain of computer geeks buying foreign luxuries, internet shopping has been embraced by everyday people. And retail volume is tripling every year.
As the product categories become broader, we've seen the growth go from $55 million 2 years ago through to $950 million in the last calendar year. And we expect it to go to about nearly $3 billion in the year 2000.
Last Christmas, nearly 600,000 Australian internet users bought their presents online, spending $149 million. Books, music, software, and of course toys were the top sellers. While American sites used to dominate the Netscape, by the end of last year, Australian retailers were getting half the internet traffic. That's an increase of more than 35% compared to the previous year. And it's estimated Australia's online shopping market will grow to 3.8 million shoppers by the end of this year.
Having grabbed their piece of the pie, e-tailers are still learning the best way to get their products to their customers. This is particularly important as one of the biggest concerns Australian buyers have is delivery times.
That's why most people are referring to the last mile issue and physical delivery as the biggest logistics nightmare.
I mean, let's face it, when you buy something, you want it straight away or as soon as you can once you've made that purchase. So from our point of view, getting it to the customer is a major goal for us quickly.
Tomorrow night, we take a look at the people behind e-tailing in Australia. The orders are flooding in, but can they deliver the goods? Australia's trailblazing internet retailers have their work cut out for them keeping their newfound customers online and attracting new ones. One major stumbling block is credit card security. In the US, cyber theft affected 6 million shoppers last year, while around half of Australia's online shoppers are concerned about credit card fraud. The New South Wales Department of Fair Trading deals with thousands of complaints from internet users each year.
If they're dealing with Australian-based traders, then we have the full weight of the consumer protection laws here in Australia, whether they be state or federal laws. But as soon as people go offshore, in many respects, they're going into the deep end of the pool, and the laws we have in Australia aren't there to protect them.
Many sites now encrypt the credit card details of their clients, while others are even offering insurance. Safe Trade reimburses customers if their credit card details are used fraudulently.
When buying over the internet, there are a few precautions you can take. Always buy from reputable sites, trust your instincts, and as a safeguard, always print out a hard copy of your purchases.
Another major concern is the high cost of shipping and handling.
One of the ones that's coming to us at the moment is, in fact, the freight costs and the exchange rate differential. Just because it's on the internet doesn't necessarily mean it's cheap, and we still urge consumers to shop around locally and compare prices.
An American study has also revealed 25% of shoppers experienced technical glitches, while 14% of goods ordered arrived late and 6% never arrived at all. And our final story tomorrow is internet shopping catching on as fast in regional areas compared to the city.
Giuseppe's celebrates its 30th birthday this year, making it Newcastle's oldest restaurant. Maria Licata is at the helm, and if you look closely, her presence spreads beyond her management title. Her creative expression began with menus, when a chance encounter at a copy shop led to more.
This woman was admiring them and telling me that I should be doing paintings, and I said, really? And she said, yes. She convinced me in 20 minutes, and the next day I started.
Maria is now putting the finishing touches on a collection of 20 bound for a Sydney restaurant. It's her fifth such order in the space of 6 months after just one trade show in Sydney, and more orders are already in the pipeline. Maria calls it her mini miracle and draws much of her inspiration from her travels to the Caribbean, Mexico, and of course, Italy.
I go through my memories, my photos, and sometimes even cookbooks. Yeah. Well, we love food as well. We love food and we love art, so this is what you get.
If all goes to plan, Maria's work will one day be seen around the world.
Just happy, bright places where there's lots of good music and good food and good-spirited people.
Catherine Turner, NBN News. The state government has been locked in secret talks with BHP for months over the future of land owned by the company in the Hunter, but today no one was prepared to elaborate.
It is true that the government for some months has been dealing with various people to try to resolve some of the land use problems in the region.
It caught the Lord Mayor's attention.
I'm interested that that's happened. I think there's a lot of scope for improvement there and opportunity.
While another minister gave a little more detail.
A number of detailed issues are still being discussed, obviously, including, very importantly, the level of remediation that's required.
All three admitted the talks are at a sensitive stage. It's understood they're centred around four sites: Kooragang Island, the steelworks site on the Hunter River, the Belmont wetlands and the former coal mining land at West Wallsend. Remediation of the contaminated sites looks set to remain BHP's responsibility, although it may get some community assistance in rehabilitating the controversial wetlands.
But there are land care and dune care groups that are here, and public and community groups that are ready and willing to help with that process.
The talks put one issue in even further doubt. The 2,000 jobs promised at the launch of Steel River 4 years ago are yet to be seen. Catherine Turner, NBN News.
We have lost our youngest son, and we grieve much. But in a sense, we have gained a whole new family.
While the Northern Blues have been playing on it for a while, the Tomaree Ground was officially opened today, with the home side grabbing an early lead. The Blues left their mark in other ways as well, with bruising runs that have made them one of the toughest teams in the competition. But when Rosella centre Gavin Cook plucked one out, it swung West's way as the visitors went up 6-2. He then saved one with another intercept, this time on his own line. Another 2 points got West's a 6-point buffer. That lead soon doubled after hooker Ryan Dagwell started things with a trademark run before Gavin Cook made an all-too-familiar path to the line as well. Scott Bradley's conversion was spot-on too. The Blues bounced back before the break, but they couldn't catch West after half-time, going down by 4.
Water quality problems in the Myall Lakes are nothing new. The system has been prone to algal outbreaks for at least the past 2 years. But National Parks and Wildlife say claims the toilets in the national park are solely to blame for the outbreaks are false.
Maybe 1% at a worst case scenario can be coming from the park. Work in the next 2 years will solve that 1%. Now we must focus on the other 99%.
The state opposition has criticised the service, blaming the outbreaks on sewage seeping from the toilets. Environment Minister Bob Davis has admitted National Parks and Wildlife disposed of raw human effluent in trenches in the Myall Lakes National Park up until 1996. But National Parks and Wildlife claim it's been given the all clear from experts.
Both DLWC, experts from CSIRO and others, but they're all pointing to the same fact that the bulk of the problem is nutrients entering the lake system from further up the catchment.
Regional manager Robert Quirk says the nutrients causing the outbreaks are coming from feeder creeks and rivers.
At least 80 to 90% are coming down the river systems from the upper catchment. There'll be diffuse sources from right across the catchment, and that's why it's harder to pinpoint the individual source.
Tanya Carlisle, NBN News.
On his 16th birthday, Jamie O'Neill said goodnight to his family and went into his caravan at Bolton Point on Lake Macquarie. Next, his father heard a loud bang.
Apparently ran alongside the caravan, and my wife came out. She tried to revive him for about 15 minutes till an ambulance got there, but they couldn't revive him.
Jamie was electrocuted on January 10 this year. A power lead from his family's Department of Housing home had energised the caravan where he lived. Evidence today made it clear a safety switch installed for $200 to $300 would have saved his life. They are fitted on all new and rewired houses. Coroner Michael Morahan said they should be a feature on every dwelling, in particular Department of Housing properties, caravan parks and boarding houses, when he recommended Australian Standard 3000 be amended to require all sources of electric supply, whether designed or capable of being adapted for domestic use, to have incorporated within their circuitry an appropriate model of safety switch. The coroner also stated that all caravans with metal framing should be earthed back to their circuitry, but that's a recommendation that's been made before, following the electrocution of a 12-year-old boy in 1975. Christopher Kebblewhite's tragic story is almost the same as Jamie O'Neill's, but the coronial findings made back then were never adopted.
Very sweeping recommendations have been made, but unless they're implemented, what's the point of it?